Each bud has to blossom one day. In the scheme of nature, every bud has to blossom one day, into its fruition, and then has to wither away to become a seed to continue the process. This process goes on at long. This is the law of nature, or hukum, or dham, or tao. The world keeps on changing. Its nature is ephemeral. Everything is short-lived. Only thing that remains ever-existent is this cosmic law. And this cosmic law, or dham, or tao, or hukum, is synergistic harmony. And this is existential, uncreated sound as well. All around a huge painting hangs, a painting that shows works of his invisible hands, that you have made a firm decision to keep your back facing the painting. Each stroke of the painting shows his work. It seems you have decided not to open your eyes to see the work. It seems an unidentified fear has gripped you. The fear is that as soon as you can see the work of invisible hands, you will not remain the same. Even if you get the slightest murmur, your entire thinking and life pattern will undergo transformation. Right now, you can do all you want to do. The moment you see his invisible hands, your liberty will vanish. That each moment you have to introspect before you undertake any action. Your total focus has to be on awareness. This is witnessing. Each moment a circumstance or situation comes, you are supposed to make a decision. You can react or you can respond. You can react from the realm of the heart, or from your intellect, then you enter into the realm of logic, or you go beyond it too, in that inner space where consciousness is, and you can respond out of that consciousness. Then it becomes witnessing. There is hidden power within that takes note of all actions and all that is happening. This is witnessing that makes sure that everything is happening according to the cosmic law. The cosmic law aims at exhausting all that guides your steps. Also, it allows each to move perennially towards the ultimate dissolution with the whole, the Nirvana. He is hidden in every particle, and when you are doing something wrong, you are in fact doing wrong with him and with him alone. As a result, there is a vast majority that does not want to see this. Seeing creates knowing, and knowing creates a problem. When you are aware of his invisible presence, we say that God is omnipresent, omniscient, and omnipotent. This is simply verbal. We do not have any slightest understanding of this. This has not become a part of our consciousness. When you are aware of his invisible presence, then you have to undergo a revolution. And this revolution is so huge that you go on ignoring. You can really ignore. The cross work is visible, however the subtle creator remains invisible. Then some say that creation is happening on its own. And this is the definition of God. And that which is happening on its own is the very nature of God. Nanak says, he is born out of his own free will. No one has created. Because of his own existence, Hindus say that he is born out of his own self-created power. He wished, Christians say that God wished and it happened. There is yet still another group that recognizes the cross work of Creator and even accepts the subtle presence. However, this acceptance is only at the intellectual level. This acceptance is out of fear. Such a person you will see in your religious place praying. The whip of life has hit him so hard that he is full of fear. This is number two man. His worship and prayer are because of security, assurance, money, prestige, and status. The third is the category of devotees or aspirants. He is aware of invisible creation. He is also seeing the grace and infinite bounties. To see this is a delicate matter. This is like seeing the shadow of the veil. He knows that he has been bestowed more than he deserves. Everyone is in fact bestowed with more than he actually deserves. But this we don't realize. And in that absence we go on begging more and more. This is like seeing the shadow of the veil. He knows that he has been bestowed more than he deserves. Now, how can he ask for more? That will mean a complaint, but all our prayers are complaints. You are given life. Is it less than it in any way? But you never seem to value life that has been given to you. And with life, an opportunity is given to you, so that one day you can attain to the solution. I have heard of a miser. He had accumulated millions. In this process, he never enjoyed life. These stories, these anecdotes, are very important in the process of transformation. Because from the very childhood we like to listen to these stories and these hang around our consciousness, we never forget. He went on postponing the rejoicing in life as normally happens. And one day death knocked at his door. He got frightened. The wealth has accumulated and he could not find time to celebrate life. So he decided to bribe 1 million to the death for 24 hours. Death refused the bargain as the money was too little. The man went on increasing the amount and finally he agreed to give 10 million for 24 hours. This was all that he had accumulated in his life. And he was ready to give all this to celebrate the life for 24 hours. He never celebrated. The open sky, the breeze, the moon, the rain, the green grass. However, death did not agree and remained adamant that no time can be given and he has to pack up and leave with death. now, this very moment. Then the man asks for a moment so he can leave the message for the future generation. And the message was, what was the message? The message was, I have wasted life in an expectation to enjoy later. And all that I earned in my life could not even earn me a moment to celebrate. And requested this to be inscribed on his grave. Such invisible message is written on each grave, but you cannot decipher. This message is relating the life of each person who is dying. Does life has any value? For a moment in life you are ready to sacrifice everything. Yet still you have not found a moment to thank the God for precious life that He has given. You may be dying in a desert place, and you are ready to give any price for a cup of water. However, so many rivers flow and clouds emerge, but you have never thanked such bounties. If suddenly sun becomes cold one day, and that life will come to cease, and you have never thanked sun. Man has his own logic. He cannot see all that he has. That which is not you go and see. Your one tooth falls, again and again the tongue reaches there. Otherwise, you will never be aware of that tooth. Human mind sees the empty spots. Man remains blind to all that is full. You never took note of all that you have. And until this account is clear, you cannot notice his bounties. At least introspect all that you have. See what you have. All around there is rain of bounties. Behind every hand, this is an invisible plane. So too, each action is his bounty. The entire existence is blossoming for you, and someone can see it. That very moment, devotion is born in you. You are devoted. Devotee is the one who is capable of seeing the invisible hands and feel the bounties that he has all around. One is an atheist, he is arrogant. The other is theist, he is shivering with fear. None of these are religious. The third is the one who is dancing out of gratitude. He is blissful because all that he has is manifold. Indeed, such a person is a devotee. Nanak says there is never an end to his actions or his bounties. Also, no one can know the inner secrets. There is no end to the extension of his creation. Many have strived to know this, but never succeed. The more you say, it goes on expanding. And your saying or singing can never exhaust his bounties or his actions. He is supreme, his status is highest, and his name is even higher than him. How can his name be greater than his? That is why Nanak gives so much importance to Naam. Naam means the name, the remembrance. For all those who are on the path, one can only reach through his name, remembrance, a constant remembrance. It is the name alone that will take you to his abode. a constant remembrance of that which is called zikr, is called naam, or whatsoever you will call. It is the bridge that connects you to Him. There will be no other way to reach if the bridge is broken. It is the bridge that connects the two realms, where you come from and where you intend to reach. The bridge takes you from one realm to another realm of the unknown. You move from the known to the unknown. The path of journey is even more important than the destination. And without a bridge, you cannot cross the ocean of life and duality. What is the ocean of life? It is the duality that you are constantly engrossed into. The heat and cold, the right and wrong, the good and bad, all these are duality. It happened. Ram, the Hindu incarnation, was seeking to cross the ocean to reach in search of Sita, Lanka, the abode of Ravana, the demon. The ocean was vast. Hanuman crossed the ocean on his own strength. The entire army cannot do so. A bridge was needed. It was decided to create a bridge over the ocean and then cross over. Now bridges to be made. Anything that was thrown in the ocean with the intention to make the bridge filled, then it was the sea god that gave the technique. The stones were to be dropped by the two monkeys. It was thought suspicious to begin the work in the hands of Ram. Any stone that Ram dropped in the ocean drowned. It was a serious problem. Hanuman suggested a device. He said the name of Ram on a stone be inscribed and dropped. Instead of drowning, it floated. When the name of Ram was written on the stone and it was thrown in the ocean, it floated. It astonished everyone, but it simply floated. Ram is one aspect of the energy, and is constant, the feminine energy. Ram represents the masculine energy, and Sita represents the feminine energy. Unless these masculine and feminine energy merge together, the bridge cannot happen. So the stone floated in the first place, is astonished, but it drifted away. There was nothing to bind it. Then two stones, one with the name Ram and the other with the name written, inscribed Sita, were thrown in the river. They bind together and they flow. So unless the masculine and feminine energy is merged into one another, the bridge cannot be established. Neither by the masculine energy nor by the feminine energy. Instead, by the merger of the two energies, the bridge can be made. And bridge is essential to cross from the dimension, from the realm of the known to the realm of the unknown. So this is the significance of the name, the significance of naam, the significance of remembrance. By inscribing the name of Ram and Sita is like being aware of their presence, that this presence surrounds us. Each look towards one another for the answer, something that has become a riddle, and Ram looked towards Hanuman for the possible solution. Hanuman said, it is quite obvious. One whom Ram leaves must definitely drown, and one who takes the support of his name, his remembrance, his awareness will float. And the two needs to be together to bind one another, the masculine and the feminine energy, the yin and yang, the feminine and the masculine aspect of the energy, Shiva and Shakti. And this is the way the life. Life is energy, and energy has two poles, male and female, positive and negative. Even the simple thing, the bulb that you have used in your house, the battery that you use in your car, has two poles. These two poles has to connect to one another. And electrician says to bridge the current. It is the connection between the two that bridges the current. Unless two energies merge into one another and unite, the illumination cannot happen. And unless two poles merge together, no transformation can really happen. Only then the journey can really begin. Both Ram and Sita represent two opposite poles of the same energy, the masculine and feminine. This is why Hindus have an incarnation where half image is that of Shiva and half is feminine. This is known as Earth means half, Nari means feminine, Ishwar, Earth Nari Ishwar, half male, half female. Nanak says the existential sound is the cosmic energy. The existential energy, both poles are embedded into it. The existential sound is the solitary truth. There is nothing more sublime than this. Bhagavad Gita begins with the remembrance of truth. It did not begin with the praise of Krishna, Radha or anything else. Ram and Sita, Radha and Krishna are two poles of the same energy. And this is why in the beginning of anything auspicious, Hindus use the word, Hindus use the sound Om. Om, in Om both poles are embedded together. There is nothing more complete and comprehensive than this sound. Such an understanding of Nanak. Nanak says one who understands the glory of this existential sound in Nam has really found the secret key. And remember the key is always bigger than the palace. The key is more important than the entire treasure hidden in the palace. That piece of iron will open the valuable treasures for you. But we do not realize the importance of the key. We say key is such a small thing, but does it matter? The moment you misplace your key, then you realize the importance of it. What is its significance for the vehicle? What is the significance of the key for the door, for the house? Once you misplace your key and you are locked out of the house, you will realize the importance of the key. One day it happened, 9:30, customer came. I had installed a digital lock, but it was not taking the program. So the key, although it was tried many times, but it was not, the digital key was not working. So I took the key, put it on my car, key bunch. But the key bunch for the showroom was different, and that did not have the key. I came out of the door to go to the other side of the showroom. I locked it and reached. The customer had gone. It is 9:30 in the night. I realized that I did not take the key for this door. You realize the significance of this. Many times before, when I was setting the lock, digital lock, it was not working. They said, if that let thy will prevail, if this is the way that I have to remain outside, I will stay. There is a chair, I can pull the two chairs and sit down on it. Then something within me tell me to try that code. I tried the code, press the unlock, with the sound, door opened. And let thy will prevail. And then I again tried the same digital code, it did not work. Then you realize the significance, how important is the key to the treasure. Nanak says, now the remembrance, the awareness, the surati is the key, is the bridge. It takes you from the known realm to the unknown realm. This key will open the door. As the surati or consciousness deepens, you have developed the key deep within. Then every moment this remembrance renews. You do not have to remember that. Anything that you see, you develop a thankful heart. Buddha told his monks to be thankful to everyone that he meets. On along the road, surati or awareness will mold your being into a key. Your entire being will become key. And suddenly that key, that capability unfolds in you. Only then you can open the door. Man has two states. One is the state of thought, and another is the state of thoughtlessness. You are in a state of thought, and constantly thoughts go on arising. Inner sky of the mind is full of clouds. Infinite thoughts scatter. One has not finished the screen, another one pops in. Infinite thoughts scatter. Your mind is like a crowded marketplace. The other is a state of no thought. The market is finished. There is silence all around. As long as you are full of thoughts, you are connected to the realm of the known, the world. And the moment thoughts are no more, inner sky is empty and you can connect to God. The moment thoughts are no more, inner sky is empty. You are connected to God. You do not have to do anything else. The door is open. Existential sound is the key to journey from thought to no thought. The moment this echo, this sound settles deep within you, you have arrived, you have attained to fana. The sound and the music is unique and sweet. It is the sound of the music of the unknown, the infinite. This sound is not man-made. It is the echo of synergistic harmony that existence is. This is the sound of the silence. This is ajapa jap or zikri khafi. One is zikri zehir, when you use the labial sound to create the sound. The other is creating the sound through labial movement. Instead, you are hearing that. And Hazrat Shah Bahauddin Naqshband emphasized that each of the seeker has to move from Zikr zihr to zikr khafi. Khafi means silent. Slowly and slowly the echo will multiply deep within. Now you have only to create this echo within. Instead you, now you have no, you need not create this echo within. Instead you have to listen as well. Slowly and slowly you will shift from doing to listening. A moment will come when doing is no more, the echo remains, and you go on listening to this. This is zikr khafi, ajab ajab. Now all channels are closed and you are hearing the echo, the unheard sound. This unheard sound, Nanak calls it as anhat naad. This is the essence of the shabad, the songs that are incorporated in the Sikh religion. And when echo happens on its own, only then you have reached, you have found the real key, the existential sound. You are not doing anything, instead it is because of your being. Now this is like the sound of flowing of a river or of a waterfall. The day you are able to hear this even once, you can listen 24 hours, each finite moment. When it comes, tension is there, so too restfulness is there. Anger comes, just close your eyes and drown in the echo of this existential sound. Everything that was discordant will vanish from your life. Like a beacon light, this existential sound will fill your being with light, and thus will vanish the darkness of lives and lives. This is the reason Nanak has given so much importance to this book. Naam. He uses the word naam for this sound. And this is called shabd or word. So in Guru Granth Sahib, all the songs that have been composed by the masters are known as shabd. They are the word, the unheard sound. That is what he calls the word. Thy name is greater than him. Nanak says he is beyond the beginning, beyond the end too. That very moment you are pulled towards him. Scientists say there is an energy that called gravitation. This energy pulls you towards itself. And you are on this earth only because of this energy. And when a spacecraft ships leave the Earth's atmosphere to go to the other planets, they are bound by the gravitational force of the Earth. The moment they reach the threshold where one gravitational force is leaving and the gravitational pull of the other is pulling, but there is a tug of war. One is pulling upward, the other is pulling downward. The man is hanging in the limbo. I have heard one day Mullah Nasruddin got a bad habit and he was caught thieving. Police caught hold of him, and when he reached in front of the judge, he pleaded, "Sir, I accept my crime, but as a punishment, do not ask me to get married a second time." Judge was astonished, what kind of punishment is he talking about? He said, "Mullah, explain why you don't want to get married a second time." He said, "When I was going to thief, I went to a house of a rich man. Only rich men can do things like that. He has two wives. One was living in the upstairs apartment and the other was living in the downstairs apartment. When I reach, I see a scene. The wife who was living in the upstairs apartment was holding on to his hands, and the one that was living in the downstairs apartment was pulling his legs. One was holding his hands and pulling him upstairs. The other was got hold of his legs and was pulling him to remain downstairs. Mulla was in limbo. So don't give me that punishment. When the spaceship reaches the threshold and ready to cross the gravitational force of the Earth to reach the gravitational force of the other planet, tremendous energy is needed. The energy that pushes it to cross over the gravitational force of the Earth, only then it can enter in the gravitational force of the other planet. This is why then you are being pulled by the senses, the five senses. You need extra force or energy or willpower to transcend that gravitational pull. And you are on the Earth, you are in the realm of senses only because of this pull that is known as gravitational pull of the Earth. So too the senses have their own gravitational force. You are beyond, and you are beyond this gravitational force, you will be lost in the sky. This is the reason. Anything that is thrown ultimately falls on the ground. In this age, there has been a beautiful woman called Simone Weil. She says that just like gravitational pull, there is another pull that is known as grace. She has written a book. She has done some work and written a couple books. She has written a beautiful book, Grace and Gravitation. You cannot see gravitation, yet still it is at work. Now the scientists are worried that gravitational pull is losing its effect. This change is at a very small pace. The trees are standing, the birds are flying, the man is walking on the surface. All this is happening because of the gravitational pull. It keeps you in balance. If this pull gets less, then the Earth will scatter. Just as you cannot see the gravitational force, you cannot see the pull of the grace. Nanak calls this as prasad. The offering that is given in the temples when the prayer is finished. The earth pulls you towards itself, that is downwards, and grace pulls you towards the infinite sky as the sound of this existential echo deepens in you. The hold of gravitation lessens. And then a stage comes when you are weightless. Now nothing can hold you onto the earth. That was the situation of Ramakrishna Paramahansa. The existential sound has deepened in him so much that there was nothing to bind him to. I have told you this story many times, but it needs remembering again and again so that it becomes part of our understanding. Ramakrishna had liked food very much. The meditation session is going on. The devotees are there. He will rush inside to the kitchen and ask, Sharda, what have you cooked? She used to feel embarrassed. She used to say Ram Krishna Dev. She always addressed him by his full name, Ram Krishna Dev. You talk like a child. Then your devotees feel embarrassed. You leave the meditation session to come inside to inquire about the food. Ram Krishna did not answer this. One day he decided to respond. He said, Sharda, I am so weightless. There is nothing on this planet that can hold me on to this, to stay here. But my boat is incomplete. The boat does not have any moorings. It can sail any moment. Have you seen a boat where you have forgotten to leave the anchors? With the current, it can drift, it can float away. So when the boat comes to the shore, the boatman releases the anchor, the moorings. There is nothing to hold me on to remain on to this shore. I have to create an anchor, and food is the anchor. The day I turn my face from the food, 3 days after I will be no more. Sharda thought that he is saying this as an excuse. Even his devotees thought so too. This is an excuse that he is giving for his liking for the food. Time flowed on. Ram Krishna reached the end of his life. He was suffering from throat cancer. He could not eat anything. He was lying on the bed, weakened. Sharda came with a platter of food, and Ram Krishna was facing Sharda. She said, Ram Krishna Dev, get up and eat food. I have prepared all the dishes that you like. As soon as Sharda uttered these words, Ram Krishna turned his face from that side to the other side. The platter slipped from the hands of Sharda. She remembered the words of Ram Krishna. The day I turned my face from the food, 3 days after I will be no more. 3 days after I will be no more. She knew that the last time has come. This was the name, the remembrance had attained the fruition into him. It has deepened into him so much that gravitational force could not pull him down. And in order to stay on, he has to create his own anchor. So does each master creates his own anchor. 3 days after Ram Krishna was to die, there were tears in the eyes of Sharda. Ram Krishna called her, Sharda, wipe out those tears. Are those tears for this body? Have you loved the body, which is ephemeral? Or you have loved something which is beyond the body? Hindus have a tradition. When a husband dies, the Hindu bride, his wife, breaks all the symbols of that makes her married. What are these symbols? The vermilion or the red color into her, on her forehead, between the part on the hair. Second is the bangles. So she has to remove all the bangles, wipe out the red color from the forehead, and she also uses a toe ring that has to be removed. Ram Krishna said, if you had loved this body, then you can remove that symbols. And if you have loved something beyond the body, then you do not remove that symbols. I will remain forever and ever with you. and in the entire history of humanity, the Hindu history, Sharda is the only wife who did not remove the singles after Ramakrishna passed away. Because for her, Ramakrishna was alive as he was during the time when he was alive. Every morning she will wake him up as usual, prepare the food for him, bring the food for him. And while she brought the platter and said, "Ramakrishna Dev, come and eat food," for 10-15 minutes, the time that he usually used to take to finish his food, she will continue to fan. This is a stage when this awareness has become part of you. Gravitational force is no more. You have reached the state of weightlessness. Now nothing can hold you onto this earth. Quite often this happens to meditators, that they begin to levitate. This is known as the state of levitation. But levitation is considered as a ritual. People come to me and they want to know if I can teach them to levitate. They feel that they have risen above the earth level. Nothing is visible outwardly. And when they open their eyes, they find themselves sitting on the ground. This is not illusion. When your mind is without any thought and memory is free, weightless, released of its garbage, your physical body remains on the earth and the causal body rises above the earth level. If this continues, then you will experience two bodies, one remaining on the ground, the other remaining above the ground, and the two remain connected by a thin silver line. Two remain connected with a thin silver line. The moment you experience that, you can remain no more the same.